The volume we have here possibly represents the greatest treasure in the university library. This is our copy of Isaac Newton's seminal work, the Philosophiae Naturalis Principia Mathematica, which was first published in 1687 under the aegis of the Royal Society. In 1684, the Royal Society commissioned Edmund Halley, whom today we best remember for the comet being named after him, to investigate the problems associated with the laws of planetary motion. And Halley was told that a mathematician called Isaac Newton claimed to have already worked out the problems associated with this by working out what he called an inverse square law, which explained how the planets and the sun reacted to each other. So Halley, accompanied by Samuel Pepys, went along to visit Isaac Newton. And Newton said, yes, he had in fact written a draft which would explain these principles, but he couldn't lay his hands on it immediately. And he was also reluctant to publish what he'd written because he'd had several disputes with other scientists of the time, notably Robert Hooke, principally about the invention of calculus and other matters. Nobody knows whether Newton invented calculus first or whether he invented it at the same time as Wilhelm Leibniz and others. But Pepys and Halley persuaded Newton to rewrite the draft, and it took him about 17 months to complete it. And then as long as Halley and Pepys undertook the publication of the book and the costs involved, he was willing to have it published. So they did so, and the book came out in an edition of about 250 copies. So any copy of the first edition like this one is a great rarity. This one, of course, is much rarer than that, in that Newton, because he was worried about claims of scientific plagiarism and other things, and about being proved factually wrong about anything, had sent copies to other mathematicians to comment on. And this resulted in these notes, which we see written at the end of this volume here. Now, three of these annotated copies were known to exist, two in Cambridge University Library and one in Trinity College, Cambridge. This is the fourth copy, and it was brought to public attention in 1908. The notes were originally thought to have been written by a Swiss mathematician called Nicolas Fascio de Duvillier and completed by Roger Coates, who was Isaac Newton's assistant later on when he was preparing the second edition. But they're now known to have been written by a man called John Craig, who was a very well-known Scottish mathematician and is of great importance in the history of the development of calculus himself. Craig wrote these notes on these four pages here and again at the end of the volume, so they're quite extensive, the comments he made. But the significance is that Newton and Coates then took these notes and interpolated them into the volume, correcting what they saw to be errors. Now, two separate handwritings appear. One associated with the correction of text is known by comparison to be Roger Coates, Newton's assistant. The hand associated with the correction of diagrams is that of Isaac Newton himself. So this copy was certainly in Newton's possession after 1687. So this makes it a work of great rarity. With the publication of this book, Newton has rightly become to be claimed the greatest writer in the history of science because he solved the laws of planetary motion, he developed the theories of gravity, and he answered all sorts of problems which were known to exist, like why pendulums operated the way they did, why tides operated the way they did, and several other matters. It's interesting that when he did the work, having been one of the inventors of calculus, he didn't use calculus at all in the text. It's mainly done through geometry and other equations. So these corrections appear throughout the text, which makes it a fairly significant work because it shows the way his mind developed and what problems he saw associated with the writing of it. How it came to be in Australia is another story. It's quite a long one. It came to the university in 1961 when it was given to the library by a woman called Barbara Bruce Smith, who lived in Bowral. And at the time when she left it to the university, Andrew Osborne, the university librarian, when he received the book, it was brought up on the train by her nephew in his briefcase and just handed it over on a Friday evening. And he was worried about leaving it in his office, so he took it home and hid it in his bookshelves at home for the weekend before bringing it back on the Monday morning before it could be accessioned into the collections. Barbara Bruce Smith had got it from her father, who was Arthur Bruce Smith, who was a barrister and Queen's Counsel. And he was also a member of both the New South Wales and Federal Parliaments and one of the draftees of the Australian Constitution. He acquired it from a Sydney resident called H.C. Elderton, sometime in 1907, as far as we know. Elderton had inherited it from a family estate, which he was the residuary legatee of. The estate was in England, in Kent, and it was named Ingham Court. Ingham Court was the property in the 1680s of one Sir Demetrius James, who was a member of the Royal Society and who was knighted in 1687, the same year the book was published. And it's probably he probably purchased this copy at that time. When Elderton inherited the estate, there were 20 boxes of books which were kept in a chapel, and they were shipped out to Australia unopened. And when Elderton, being a book collector, opened the chests out here, a copy of the Principia was included among the books. And he advertised the fact around Sydney that he'd acquired this, and Bruce Smith obviously made him an offer he couldn't refuse. Bruce Smith notified the world of the existence of this copy by writing letters to the editor of Nature. I think that from memory, these appeared in April and December 1908, and this was the first indication that this book existed. So it's a story which, if you read it in a book, you wouldn't believe it. That's such a long, convoluted tale of how the book came to Australia, but it probably is the greatest treasure that exists in the university library.